My name is Marion. I'm from the blog Miss Mustard Seed, and in this video I'm going to show how to reupholster the back of a wood framed chair. So this will work for any kind of chair where there's a wood frame and upholstery in the middle. So it doesn't necessarily have to be this style, but that same idea. So I made a slipcover for the bottom, and now I want to remove this upholstery that came with the chair. It really was too light. We were getting all kinds of staining on the seat, which I knew would happen. So I was planning on recovering them anyway. But I also like to personalize stuff for my own space. So the first thing we have to do is remove the piping or the double welting here and remove the fabric. And we do have to remove it entirely because we're going to replace the back panel of fabric as well. And this is visible, so we're gonna put a coordinating fabric here. So the tools that I'm using are, this is actually a pair of wire cutter pliers. So they have a pointed nose and have they're kind of clippers, I guess. And they're good for pulling out staples and also cutting off staples. And then I also have a staple puller, and this is a piece that's meant for upholstery. I like to pick these up when I'm at antique stores and stuff. I'll look where they have a lot of tools, and oftentimes you'll find some really cool old staple pullers that work pretty well. So this is one of those that I picked up that was an antique. And then I have the pieces that I'm gonna use to recover it, but I'm gonna set those aside for right now. So I would also recommend, I'm only doing one of these, and so I'm not going to put on gloves at the moment, but when you're working on several of these or working on a big project, you definitely want to wear gloves, because these tools and the pulling and everything will eventually start to hurt your hands. So I may even put on gloves as I get into this if it's bugging me. So what I do with the welting is I kind of grab it with the pliers and then roll it. And that pulls out. Now, this is staple. A lot of welting is glued, and I kind of prefer the glue, but because now I have all these staples I have to remove, which is kind of a bummer. Did you see how well twisting it works? And then I don't have to use quite as much muscle. Okay, that part is off. Oh, now I've just got like a million staples to rock out. So I recommend having a little bowl or a dish on hand to put your staples in. And always like sweep or vacuum right afterwards so your family doesn't step all over staples. And when I'm rocking my wire cutter pliers here, I'm rocking them into the upholstery and away from the frame. And the reason being is you don't want to pull them towards the frame because you can damage the wood frame. A little damage might happen, but you just want to be as gentle as you can be, especially because I'm not planning on painting this or anything, so I want to try to keep it in good shape. Okay, I got all those staples out. That probably took about maybe 8 minutes or so, so not too terrible of a process. Now, if you're not changing out the fabric on the back, you really could just cut your fabric and staple it right over this, and that would be totally fine. A bit of a shortcut, but totally fine. But I want to change mine out. So now what I need to do is, let's see, that this is where these might come in handy. So when it comes to your tools, you just use whatever is working for you. I used to use, you know, try to use like the staple pullers that were meant for upholstery and all that. And I just found I really preferred wire cutting pliers that are not meant for upholstery, but that's what worked best for me. Okay, so I've got enough staples off here, almost, so that I can start pulling off the fabric. And what I like to do with this is sometimes I'll get lucky and staples will come out with the fabric. That does not happen with these though. With these, just the fabric comes out. But the reason why I'm doing this is because I really just need the fabric out. I don't need every single staple out. So if there are some staples left in there, that's okay. I'm just going to be putting more staples in. So as long as the like around the edge is kind of smooth, then that's totally okay. Now, for some people, that drives them crazy. You have to remove every single little scrap and staple. And I'm just not like that. It's going to be all covered, so as long as it looks okay on the top and the staples aren't, you know, impeding the new staples at all, it is not going to bother me. There we go. That section's off. Now, usually there's a piece of foam like this. This is a modern chair, so sometimes it's, you know, just normal foam. This is in nice shape. Sometimes it's looks more like cotton batting. You could have some webbing here as well to provide additional support. Okay, and I'm going to do the same thing with this next layer of fabric. I'm taking a second though to pull out any staples that are loose, like they're just sticking out, so I don't get myself hung up on them. Finally found a spot. This one was really on there. Okay, there we go. Okay. Now I just need to clean up the frame enough so I can put new staples on. So what I want to get off is, you know, any of the like fabric bits, most of them anyway, a few won't be a big deal. And I want to get up any staples that are kind of sticking up. As much as I want to clear it off, and that took about another maybe 8 to 10 minutes, and now I'm ready to staple it on. Now, those of you who are like perfectionists, this having staples still on might not be okay for you, but I assure you it's okay as long as they're not bulky to the point where they are going to kind of impede the new staples that go on. Okay, so I've got everything stripped off the frame that I want to have off of it, and now I'm going to start the upholstery. So for the back of the chair, I'm going to use this antique grain sack fabric, and because it has a stripe down the middle, it's important to make sure that I get that stripe centered. Now, it is a little tricky with grain sack stripes to get them straight because the stripes themselves tend to be a little irregular, so, and also the back of these chairs are curved a bit, so I found that the stripes on all of them do look like they curve a little bit, but again, I'm not too concerned with that. I'm not a perfectionist though, if you haven't figured that out. So I'm getting this first bit lined up and centered like that. And I've just stapled it to the top. And I've said this before, when I'm upholstering something, I always go in a north, south, west, east, or east-west pattern. And that makes sure that I'm not going to end up with, you know, if I do all of this side, I might end up being too short on this side. So it just kind of helps to make sure everything's lined up and I have plenty of fabric. Okay, so I need to look at this head on to make sure I'm getting it as straight as I can. And the part of the fabric that's going to be seen is this part. So you want to make sure that the fabric is facing out. Okay, and I'm stapling my west side and then now the east side. And you want to be careful when you're doing this too to not pull the fabric too tight. Otherwise, you can kind of pull the stripe off center. Okay, and then from here, I'm just going to now staple each quarter of the chair until it's all done. And a little bit about the staple gun. So this is it's hissing a little bit. This is a pneumatic staple gun. It is meant for upholstery. What that means, it's basically a regular staple gun, but it has a longer nose on it. So I'm able to get it into some of the tight corners when I'm doing upholstery. It's made by Porter Cable, and this is the one I've used for years. I also have a Porter Cable. It's a 135 PSI, 2.6 C. Anyway, it's a 6 gallon, 135 PSI little pancake compressor, so I can kind of carry it around and use it where I need it. And I've used that for upholstery for a long time as well. So I'm going to go ahead and get the rest of this stapled. And then I'll show you what we'll do next. Okay, so the back is all stapled on. So one thing that you want to double check for is to make sure you don't have any staples that are popped out the back. Actually, I have one. I'm going to pop a new one in. Okay, that one went in well. And now I'm going to trim off the excess. And I've used a lot of different scissors for this kind of project, this trimming. And these are the best. These are the Fiskars Easy Action. You can find these on Amazon or in sewing shops. And the great thing about these is they just have these little, you know, just these little blades, but they spring back open easily. They're actually made for, I think, people who have arthritis and have difficulty using scissors, but these are great for trimming upholstery. I don't know why my gun keeps hissing. I think I need to add some more Teflon tape to the threading or the gun meets the compressor. Okay, here we go. So the back is done. Not too bad. All right, and now we're going to get the padding put back on. If the padding that's in your chair is not in good shape, then I would suggest replacing it. You can get foam in just about any sewing store or places that carry upholstery supplies. Okay, and then we're going to add this on. And again, we've got a geometric pattern, so I want to make sure that it's lined up nice and straight. Not crooked, so I have to look at it head on here. Okay, looks good. And same thing, I'm going to be doing stapling it on in a north, south, east, west pattern. I'm just going to trim off this excess fabric. Now, you may be wondering why I didn't use the fabric I removed as a template and get this exact. The reason why I don't do that, I have learned, well, and I will, let me back up and say, I will use pieces that I remove as templates if they're more complicated than an oval. I will use them as templates, but I do still cut the fabric pretty generously. And the reason why I do that is because different fabrics have different stretch to them. And so the fabric that I'm using might stretch a little bit more or less. So if I cut it to the exact size, it might not fit properly. So I like to give myself a lot of room to work with. It does make, you know, trimming a little bit of a pain at the end. But like I said, these scissors work really well. So I'm able to get a nice tidy edge. And now we just need to attach the double welting. If you've watched my upholstery videos before, you know how I do this, but I attach my trim using a hot glue gun. And there is upholstery glue that you can use for trim, but I just like hot glue because it glues it instantly, and I have never had a problem with any of it like coming up or anything like that. And then when I want to remove it, I can just yank it right off. So I've taken apart a lot of chairs, and I've also upholstered a lot of chairs, and using glue and hot glue is just fine. I'm going to start off by trimming an end off so that I have a nice clean end to work with. And I'm going to put the seam where the ends meet at the bottom. So that's where I'm going to start. You want to try to put it in, like, you know, an inconspicuous place as much as possible. And then I'm just going to hold the double welting in place. You want to have it pushed down tight right inside this edge of the frame, so it looks really sharp, and just let it follow the curve. You also want to make sure that you don't have any upholstery fabric sticking out under the welting. So you just get this nice clean edge and that it covers all the staples. Now, if you don't want to make your own double welting, you can buy double welting that's just in a solid color. It doesn't look quite as sharp or as custom. You can also use, it's called GIMP. It's just kind of a braided cord. There's all kinds of things that you can do to cover the staples, so double welting is not your only option. It is kind of time consuming and a pain to make, so there have been many times where I'm like, I'm not doing it. But in the case of these chairs, it really wasn't that much, so I decided to do it. And if you'd like to know how to make double welting, I do have a video tutorial on that, and I'll put the link in my blog post and also in the down bar of the YouTube video. I wanted to bring you in for this part so you could see how the edges meet. So I've got this excess bit, I've got a nice clean cut here, and I'm going to try to cut it so that the ends will meet almost exactly. I'm going to add just a little bit more though, because it's better to have a little more. I can always trim it if I need to, but I can't add any more back on. And then I'm going to put the glue in and put some glue on the end as well. Watch your fingers because the glue is hot. You can always use like popsicle sticks if you're really sensitive to glue gun burns. I have like oven mitt hands, but if you're really sensitive, you can always use a popsicle stick to hold things down. Okay, and I've got a little bit of extra here, so I'm going to trim that off and just kind of mush it all down. There we go. That's how I do my edges. It helps to get a little bit of glue kind of between them so it holds all the edges down and prevents fraying.
And if you do get any glue hot glue on your frame, you can just easily scrape it off. That's another nice thing about hot glue.
And there we go. This chair is done. You can see the slipcover I did. Here's how it looks from the back. For more upholstery and sewing tutorials, you can check out my YouTube channel, and you can also visit my blog at missmustardseed.com.